All right. So yes. So greetings really from Finland, the Rye country. We are here in the north of the European Rye Belt. So this is really in the bubble, the area where rye is most of the rye in the globally is grown. And here in Finland, first of all, sorry, I just take the snapshot away. Okay, rye is really our national bread. It was voted in the Finnish when Finland became independent, had the 100th anniversary of the independence a few years ago. So we had national voting for national food, and really rye bread was selected. And the motivation was because it's so healthy. It has very long roots in history, and it lives and is renewing itself all the time. And I will show you how it has happened. Now there are problems. All right. So if you look at the consumption of rye, really globally, it's a minor grain. In the US, you are hardly consuming it, even you have some nice photos, and I know that locally somewhere you have it. But as you see, in Europe, it's slightly more, and Finland is really, we are heavy users of rye. So we are eating like 44 grams per day per capita of that. And we even have a National Bread Day, which was just a week ago. So it's always the last day of February. And really, rye is the most important European bread grain after wheat. So it's seldom thought over, especially in the US, but it's really the other major bread grain here. And it's the beauty is that it is really still now used as whole grain bread, and they are made with sourdough fermentation because rye gluten doesn't form the structure of the bread, and the sourdough is needed to structurize and make the bread a good texture. And also it changes, like Marco Copetti was telling, many other features here. And it has the highest fiber content of all grains. It's very rich really in arabinoxylan, the special fiber, and phytochemicals. And there has been extensive research in the last 25 years about both the chemistry and the nutrition physiology and the health effects of grains in intervention studies, and also lately in epidemiological studies. And we really know that it's very good, like other whole grains, but especially good for reducing the risk of type 2 diabetes, for example, and against metabolic syndrome. And as I will show, there has been a continuous product development, and the rye bread current as of now is really different than it was like 30 years ago, the major bread. So in Finland, how is the bread like? In the early days, the traditional form was a round flat bread, with a hole in center. And even we are a small country, not perhaps geographically, but not anyway big, we have a very rich bread culture. And in the Eastern Finland, the bread was baked every week. So we were eating there soft bread. And in the Western part, only a few times a year. And then that was the crisp bread then, which was eaten, and it was often moistened before eating. And the fiber content also in the bread is really high. If it's crisp bread, it can be as high almost as in the flour, like 20%. But normally in rye bread, it's 10 to 15%. And about the traditional home baking, where it all started, and this is actually, I have taken these photographs myself, and there's a baker in my village who is still baking rye bread, and I have the privilege of receiving it every now and then. So it was baked in old, typically wooden containers, which were also inherited, like the sourdough starter culture from generation to generation. This reservoir here is about 50 years old, said the lady. And the sourdough is really staying overnight, and then we have the slurry, and then the dough is made. And then it's baked like every bread, but it's very dense and very hard dough. And then baked at a very high temperature, and the crust is then very hard, and the loaves are really heavy. Like these loaves she's baking, they're like 1 kilogram each. So that's a tradition, and also of course they were produced commercially, and still you can buy them commercially produced. But currently our breads look like you see here in these pictures. Consumers prefer milder taste and also convenience and not using knife and easy to eat and easy to take with you. And most of the breads are now like these shredded rolls in two pieces. They made like a bun, but of course the structure is very different. Typically, these are quite hard textures for a person used to white wheat bread, but the, like the lower bread here is a very new one from this year, and there are all kinds of rye breads also in Finland currently, and when we are in the old-fashioned rye bread, it was only rye flour, water and salt and the starter, but these days also malt, wheat flour, other flours, potato flakes, gluten are mixed if we want to make softer textures. And still there are lots of proprietary sourdough starters in the used in the bakeries, but of course also commercial starters may be used. And then we have also a very rich crisp bread culture in the Nordic countries. And that has led then later to all kinds of snacks. We have rye chips, we have nachos, we have whatever flavored snacks, which are really a healthy option in their category. They are very popular as well. They typically contain 10 to 20% dietary fiber, and more come all the time to the market. So then, what about rye bread in nutrition and health then? Really the most important part was long thought to be and still probably is this rye fiber. I have in a kind of logo here the cross section, a microscopy photograph of the rye grain, and the blue color which you see there is the fiber. So the cell walls of the rye grain have been colored. In this case, it's the other major dietary fiber component. It's beta-glucan, which has been colored blue. And what is specific also for rye grain is that the fiber is present throughout the grain. In many other grains, more of the fiber is on the outer parts of the grain, but rye, in rye, it is very evenly distributed. So we, and there are lots of studies about the fermentability and effects of rye fiber. But then we have learned now during the, let's say, last 25 years that it's not only rye fiber, it's a full complex of compounds in concerted action for health. And we already heard in the first talk about all the phytochemicals and all the micronutrients also, which are present also in other grains. But in the Nordic countries, we have really been in the forefront of this research, and we have extensively studied rye for those. And really, if we think that in the grain, we have the macronutrients, and that's of course why we want to eat cereals, because we, especially in the old times, we needed lots of energy from grains. And then we have the fiber, but then we have all the other components which are present in the same parts of the grain and associated with the grain cell walls. And we call it the dietary fiber complex. And in the next, and really, as I said, rye is the richest grain of all others in terms of fiber content. And it's also really rich in all these phytochemicals and micronutrients. And if we think of the diet in Finland, for example, so it's really important source of all of these in our diet. And we have studied in both in rye, also in wheat, many of these compounds, but especially in the Nordic countries, we have studied these compounds, how they are where they are present, in which quantities, in all groups, especially in alkyl resorcerins, for example, or in lignans. There's an array of compounds which are also grain-specific. So, for example, alkyl resorcerins, and perhaps Marika will tell more about that, they have They have been noted to be good biomarkers of whole grain intake, and there are specific algal resources where we can differentiate between rye eaters and whole grain wheat eaters in epidemiological studies. And that has led to the fact that we can better link rye intake to certain endpoints also. But there are a huge array of these compounds. We have done several PhDs of all of them, how they are metabolized, they are typically metabolized and then they disappear from the circulation. So continuously, if we are eating rye bread like many of us are, we are in the dynamic state of having different metabolites and some of the precursors here. And many of them are metabolized in the colon. Some are already absorbed in the upper GI tract. So, and there's still lots of ongoing research on how they all contribute then to different health aspects. So if we think in nutrition, really that's, rye was long the largest source of fiber, and it's still, I think, the largest single source of fiber. It provides about half of our cereal fiber intake, and which means like 25-30% of total dietary fiber intake in Finland. And even we are eating quite a lot of whole grain bread, we still are not meeting the recommendations, which are 25 for minimum for women and 35 for men, or 3 grams per megajoule. But still, without the rye bread, we would consume much less. And there has been lots of campaigns and dissemination about this fact, because it would be quite easy to increase the fiber intake by eating like one, two slices more rye bread every day. And here I have another micrograph of the rye kernel, and then I have two micrographs which show how the fiber looks like in bread. And especially the outer parts of the grain, they are very stable. So even in the sourdough fermentation, which solubilizes fiber and changes, hydrolyzes proteins and changes the texture of bread, many of these outer parts of the grain are still present as large particles in the bread. And depending on the type of fermentation and if we use enzymes and so on, we might then get more degradation of the fiber particles. And we have also analyzed fecal samples of people after intervention when they have been eating rye bread. And depending on the gut microbiota activity, some people even secrete parts of the fiber. But the majority of these particles are fermented by the colonic microbiota. And at the same time, the phytochemicals are then converted to the mammalian metabolites. And so one important site for the rye bread to act is in the colonic fermentation. But the other factor we have studied a lot in Finland, but also in our neighbor countries, is the what we call rye factor. And it is the fact that after eating of rye bread, we need less insulin to control the glucose levels in serum. And it means that as we are repeatedly eating bread and meals, it is good that we don't have to secrete so much insulin. And this has been thought to be suggested to be one of the mechanisms why rye bread consumption has been suggested to be protected towards impaired glucose tolerance and also type 2 diabetes. But we still don't know the fact why this is, because the glucose responses of white wheat bread and rye bread are typically rather similar, even then in the when longer time has elapsed from the eating of the meal, then the blood glucose remains higher as less insulin has been secreted. And that is very good, because then we don't have so sharp peaks of glucose going up and down. And that is again a positive thing. And we think that one of the reasons here is that rye bread is very different structure-wise from wheat bread. It's harder, it's dense. We have studied a lot the microstructure. Here I have two micrographs here with we have iodine stained starch, and you can see here is wheat bread, and protein is stained green here. So gluten is forming the network, and as we know, and starch is embedded, the starch granules are embedded in the network. Whereas in rye bread, the starch granules are more swollen. Arabinoxylan is actually very important for the structure formation. And we have also, so this is more pasta type structure in rye bread. Also, when we have studied after mastication, the particles remain larger after in the bolus and when we are swallowing the rye bread. And that may be one of the reasons for the different insulin metabolism. So then some words about the rye networks and the Nordic collaboration, because that has really been extensive amount of research we have been doing. It started actually in 94, and we had a network of research institutes and universities in different Nordic countries. And we had also a group of rye bread producing companies who were partly funding it. We had Nordic and national funding from different sources, but they were very actively also joining especially in the early phases when we started to recognize all the phytochemicals and start study their metabolism. They were very actively involved, and they were also disseminating the knowledge and picking it up. And all the, at the same time, they were developing these new rye breads. So they tried to understand very well what is important for the health aspects of rye bread and develop consumer products which are then acceptable and would be new. We also had then thereafter two Nordic centers of excellence, one on whole grain and another on systems biology in nutrition, also working on whole grain. And then currently we are having this Nordic Rye Forum. You can visit the webpage if you wish, where actually already the second generation scientists are collaborating now and working for the future. And we started really having rye symposia already in the 90s. We were at that time writing leaflets. We also have written jointly in the Nordic group a book which was published by the Cereals and Grains Association a few years ago. And really in this network currently, I'm sure we also have major companies, the biggest rye bakeries are actually Nordic these days, so it's very easy for them to work also at the Nordic level. And then the group of scientists has expanded because also the groups working in the Nordic Centers of Excellence became on board. And we a few years ago also wrote one review together about where we are, kind of summary, and where we should go to. And there's active ongoing research a lot, and Marjukka will tell more about the latest research soon. And lastly then, we have also networking and we are collaborating in our small country, Finland, to communicate and disseminate rye and rye bread. We have Finnish bread information producing materials, making campaigns, organizing a week of bread. They are organizing also the rye bread, which I showed at the beginning, having seminars, articles, and so on, collaborating a lot and with the scientists, and they were also involved in many of the projects to pick up the results when they are coming and popularizing them. So we have had lots and lots of papers in daily newspapers about rye and rye bread. And then we have another association which is called Pro Ruis with Pro Rye, and they are more linked to the farmers and the whole and the primary production, linking farmers and industry, but also working to increase the interest of rye by consumers. And because Finland has not been recently in the 10 years ago, a big rye producing country. It's easier to produce rye in the Central Europe, but it is our national bread. There has been a strong wish to be self-sufficient in rye, and that is what has been achieved now. And we have good harvests. We have also a lot of contract farming, and we have dedicated people who are working to increase the harvests and cultivate rye. So So really, that was my story, as you see, both in science and in bakery and by consumers. Rye is really a national thing, and especially the whole grain bread. It has been a cornerstone of our diet. It has provided long-lasting energy in the past when we had to work physically hard, and now that we are typically overweight and don't exercise enough, rye bread is also a good option because it's so good for our metabolic to alleviate metabolic stress. Thank you.